This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book The Turkish Empire, Its Growth and Decay by Lord Eversley. Part 1, The Growth of Empire. 1. Othman, 1288-1326. Towards the middle of the 13th century, a small band or tribe of nomad Turks migrated from Khorasan, in Central Asia, into Asia Minor. They were part of a much larger body, variously estimated at from 2,000 to 4,000 horsemen, who, with their families, had fled from their homes in Khorasan under Suleiman Shah. They had been driven thence by an invading horde of Mongols from farther east. They hoped to find asylum in Asia Minor. They crossed into Armenia and spent some years in the neighborhood of Erzurum, plundering the natives there. When the wave of Mongols had spent its force, they proposed to return to Khorasan. On reaching the Euphrates River, Suleiman, when trying on horseback to find a ford, was carried away by the current and drowned. This was reckoned as a bad omen by many of his followers. Two of his sons, with a majority of them, either returned to Central Asia or dispersed on the way there. Two other sons, Ertorul and Dundar, with 420 families, retraced their course and, after spending some time again near Erzurum, wandered westward into Asia Minor. They came into a country inhabited by a kindred race. Successive waves of Turks from the same district in Central Asia, in the course of the three previous centuries, had made their way into Asia Minor and had taken forcible possession of the greater part of it. They formed there an empire, known as that of the Seljukian Turks, with Konya, the ancient Iconium, as its capital. But this empire, by the middle of the 13th century, was in a decadent condition. It was eventually broken up in part by assaults of a fresh swarm of invaders from Central Asia, and in 14 part by internal civil strife, fomented by family disputes of succession. When Ertorul's band appeared on the scene, Sultan Alaeddin ruled at Konya over what remained to him of the Seljukian state. Other remnants of it survived under independent emirs at Karamania, Sarakan, Mench, and numerous other smaller states. Between them, they possessed nearly the whole of Asia Minor, with the exception of a few cities in its northwest, such as Brusa, Nicaea, and Nicomedia, and the districts round them, and a belt of territory along the Bosphorus, the Sea of Marmora, and the Hellespont, to which the Byzantine emperors, formerly the owners of nearly the whole of Anatolia, were now reduced. Two small Christian states also still existed there, Trebizond in the northeast and Little Armenia in Cilicia in the southeast. Though divided among many independent emirs, the people of Asia Minor, with the exception of the Greeks and Armenians, were fairly welded together. The invading Turks had intermixed with the native population, imposing on them the Turkish language, and had themselves adopted the religion of Islam. Ertorul and his nomad tribe, before entering this country, were not Muslims, but they were not strangers in language. Whatever their religion, it was held lightly. They were converted to Islam after a short stay in the country, and, as is often the case with neophytes, became ardent professors of their new faith. The oft-told story of the first exploit of Ertorul and his 420 horsemen on coming into the country of the Seljuks, as handed down by tradition, though savoring somewhat of a myth, is as follows. They came unexpectedly upon a battle in which one side was much pressed. They knew nothing of the combatants. Ertorul spoke to his followers, "Friends, we come straight on a battle. We carry swords at our side. To flee like women and resume our journey is not manly. We must help one of the two. Shall we aid those who are winning or those who are losing?" Then they said unto him, "It will be difficult to aid the losers. Our people are weak in number, and the victors are strong." Ertorul replied, "This is not the speech of bold men. The manly part is to aid the vanquished." Thereupon the whole body of them fell upon the Mongols, who were 15 the winning side, and drove them into flight. The side to which they brought aid and victory proved to be that of Sultan Alaeddin of Konya. In return for this providential aid, Sultan Alaeddin made a grant of territory to Ertuğrul to be held as a fief under the Seljuks. It consisted of a district at Sugut, about 60 miles southeast of Brusa, and a part of the mountain range to the west of it. Ertuğrul and his horsemen were a welcome support to Alaeddin's waning fortunes. In a later encounter with a small Byzantine force, they came off victorious, and Alaeddin made a further addition to their territory on the borders of his own, over which he had a very nominal sovereignty. Thenceforth, Ertuğrul lived an uneventful pastoral life as the head of his clan or tribe of Turks in the ceded territory, till his death in 1288, nearly 50 years from the date of his leaving Khorasan. His son Othman, who was born at Sugut in 1258, was chosen by the clan to succeed him, and soon commenced a much more ambitious career than that of his father. When of the age of only 16, he had fallen in love with the beautiful daughter of Sheikh Idbali, a holy man of great repute in Karamania. It is evidence of the small account then held of Ertuğrul and his son that the Sheikh did not think the marriage good enough for his daughter. It was only after a long and patient wooing by Othman, and as the result of a dream which foretold a great future of empire for his progeny, that Idbali gave consent to the marriage. There were no contemporary Turkish histories of the early Ottoman sultans. It was not till many years after the capture of Constantinople in 1453 that Turkish historians wrote about the birth of their state. They had to rely upon traditions, which must be accepted with much reserve. This, however, is certain, that Othman, in his 38 years of leadership, increased his dominion from its very narrow limits at Sugut and Eskişehir to a territory extending thence northward to the Bosphorus and Black Sea, a distance of about 120 miles by an average breadth of 60 miles, an area of about 7,000 square miles. There are no means of estimating its population. It was probably sparse, except on the coast of the Marmora and Black Sea. It included only one important city, Brusa, which was surrendered by its garrison and citizens shortly before the death of Othman XVI in 1326, after being hemmed in and cut off from communication with Constantinople for many years. Considerable as these additions were, the nascent state could not even yet be considered as important in size. It was exceeded by several of the larger Turkish emirates in Asia Minor, such as Karamania, Sarakan, and others. It is notable that Othman, from the outset of his career, devoted his efforts not against the Turkish Muslim states lying to the south and west of him, but against the territory to the north in possession of the Byzantine Empire, or which had recently been more or less emancipated from it and inhabited chiefly by Christians. It is to be inferred from this that the motive of Othman was partly a religious one, to extend Islam. This was not effected by any signal victories over the armies of the Greek Empire. There was only one recorded battle against any army of the emperor, that at Baphuan, near Nicomedia, where Othman, who by this time reckoned 4,000 horsemen among his followers, defeated the inconsiderable body of 2,000 Byzantine troops. In the following year, 1302, the Greek emperor, Michael Palaeologus, alarmed at the progress of Othman, crossed in person into Asia Minor at the head of a small army of mercenary Slavs. But he brought no money with him to pay his soldiers. They would not fight without pay. They dispersed, and Michael was obliged to return to his capital. This was his last attempt to defend his remaining territory in that district. He was hard-pressed in other directions by other Turkish emirs in Asia Minor, and in the first decade of the 14th century, the Greek Empire lost all its possessions in the islands of the Aegean Sea. The extensions of territory by Othman, during his long reign of 38 years, were effected by a slow process of attrition, by capturing from time to time petty fortresses and castles and annexing the districts round them. He acted in this respect, in the earlier stages, as fief of the Seljuk state, but later, when that empire came to an end, Othman declared his independence and thenceforth his accretions of territory were on his own behalf. It would seem that, as these additions were made, their populations, or the greater part of them who were Christians, adopted Islam, not under compulsion, for there is no record of the massacre of captives, or of the sale of them as slaves 17, but because they were abandoned by their natural protectors, the Greeks of Constantinople. The important fact, clearly shown by Mr. Gibbons in his recent work, is that the new state thus created by Othman did not consist purely of Turks. It had a very large mixture of Greeks and Slavs, who were welded with Turks by the religion of Islam. They were, from an early period, very distinct from the people of other Turkish states. They called themselves Osmanlis. The term Turk was used by them rather as a term of contempt for an inferior people, as compared with themselves. It was only in later years, when the other Turkish states of Asia Minor were incorporated in the empire, that the term Turk was applied to its people, in the first instance by outsiders and eventually by themselves. To Othman, therefore, is due the credit of this inception of a new state and a new and distinct people. He did not, however, assume the title of Sultan. He was simply an emir, like so many other rulers of petty states in Asia Minor. He was not a great general. He had no opportunity of conducting a great campaign. He was a brave soldier and a sagacious leader, who inspired confidence and trust in his followers and subjects. He pursued with great persistency the policy of enlarging his domain. He was also a wise and capable administrator, and was assisted in this by his father-in-law, Idbali, who acted as his vizier. He meted out equal justice to all his subjects, irrespective of race and religion. He was simple and unostentatious in his habits. There is no record of his having more than one wife or more than two sons. He did not amass wealth. He divided the loot of war equally among his soldiers, setting apart a portion for the poor and orphans. Othman had a vein of cruelty in his character, as had so many of his descendants, the Ottoman sultans. When on one occasion he propounded to his war council a scheme of further aggression on his neighbors, his uncle, Dündar, a nonagenarian who had been companion in arms to Ertuğrul, ventured to raise objection to the policy of further extension. Othman, instead of arguing the question with him, took up his crossbow and shot his uncle dead on the spot, and in this way closured the discussion and put down at the outset opposition in the council. Von Hammer, in relating this story, says, "This murder of the uncle marks with terror the commencement of the Ottoman dominion, as the brother's murder did that of Rome, only the former rests on better historical evidence." Idris, the Turkish historian, who at the beginning of his work declares that, passing over in silence all that is reprehensible, he will only hand down to posterity the glorious deeds of the royal race of Othman, relates among the latter the murder of Dündar. If then such a murderous slaughter of a relative be reckoned by the panegyrists of the Osmanlis among their praiseworthy acts, what are we to think of those which cannot be praised, and of which their history therefore is silent? We must judge of Othman, however, not by the standard of the present time, but by that of his contemporaries. By that standard he was reckoned a humane and merciful sovereign. This view is expressed in the prayer which has been used in the religious ceremony, on the accession of every one of his successors to the throne, when he is girt with the double-edged sword of the founder of the empire, may he be as good as Othman. In his old age, when Othman was incapable of taking the field himself, his son Orchan took his place as the leader of the army, and just before the death of Othman, Brusa surrendered to him. It was then, as now, one of the most important cities in Asia Minor. When Othman was on his deathbed, after a reign of 38 years, his son Orchan, in terms of affection and lamentation, addressed him, "O Othman, thou fountain of emperors, lord of the world, thou conqueror and subduer of nations." The dying king replied, "Lament not, O my sons, delight, for this my last conflict is the lot of all humankind, common to young and old, who equally breathe the air of this malignant world. Whilst I now pass to immortality, live thou glorious, prosperous, and happy. Since I have thee for successor, I have no cause to grieve at my departure. I will give thee my last instructions, to which be attentive. Bury the cares of life in oblivion. I conjure thee, crowned with felicity, lean not to tyranny, nor so much as look towards cruelty. On the contrary, cultivate justice, and thereby embellish the earth. Rejoice, my departed soul, with a beautiful series of victories, and when thou art become conqueror of the world, propagate religion by thy arms. Promote the learned to honor, so the divine law shall be established, and in what place soever thou hearest a learned man, let honor, magnificence, 19, and clemency attend him. Glory not in thy armies, nor pride thyself in thy riches. Keep near thy person the learned in the law, and as justice is the support of kingdoms, turn from everything repugnant thereto. The divine law is our sole arm, and our progress is only in the paths of the Lord. Embark not in vain undertakings or fruitless contentions. For it is not our ambition to enjoy the empire of the world, but the propagation of the faith was my peculiar desire, which therefore it becomes thee to accomplish. Study to be impartially gracious to all, and take care to discharge the public duties of thy office, for a king not distinguished by goodness belies the name of a king. Let the protection of thy subjects be thy constant study, so shalt thou find favor and protection from God. It is probable that much of this was the invention of some historian, writing many years later. It may be taken, however, as a summary, based on tradition, of the principles which had actuated the dying chief during his long reign. Othman died shortly after receiving the welcome news of the surrender of Brusa, and by his last wish was buried there. He was the progenitor of a royal race who, for 9 more generations, continued the career of conquest which he inaugurated, till the empire, in the middle of the 16th century, 278 years from the accession of Othman, under Suleiman the Magnificent, the greatest of his race, reached its zenith. It was only after 10 generations of great sultans that the race seemed to be exhausted, and thenceforth, with rare exceptions, produced none but degenerates down to the present time. 2. Orchan, 1326-59. Othman, on his deathbed, designated as his successor the younger of his 2 sons, Orchan, aged 42, who had been brought up as a soldier under his father's eye, and had shown capacity in many campaigns, and especially in that resulting in the surrender of Brusa. Aladdin, the elder brother, was not a soldier. He had led a studious life, devoted to religion and law, both founded on the Quran, under the guidance of Idbali. The Turkish historians agree in stating that Orchan was most unwilling to act on his father's wishes and take precedence over his elder brother, and that he proposed to divide the heritage of state between them, but that Aladdin declined the offer. Orchan is then reported to have said, "Since my brother, thou wilt not take the flocks and herds which I offer thee, be the shepherd of my people. Be my vizier." Aladdin agreed to this, and devoted himself to the administration of the growing state and to the organization of the army under the rule of his brother. Orchan followed closely the example of his father. He pursued the same method of slow, but sure and persistent aggrandizement of his state. It will be seen that he succeeded in adding to it a territory nearly 3 times greater than that which he inherited. 2/3 of this were in the northwest corner of Asia Minor, along the shore of the Marmora and the Dardanelles, and the remaining 1/3 in Europe, where he was the first to make a lodgment for the Ottomans. He made Brusa his capital, and there, after a time, he assumed the title of Sultan. He coined money with the inscription, "May God cause to endure the empire of Orchan, son of Othman." The phrase must be taken rather as a measure of his ambition than as a description of his existing state, for it was then inferior in size to several of the Turkish emirates in Asia Minor and to most of the Balkan states. Orchan led a most active and simple life. He was always on the move. When not in the field with his troops, he spent his time in visiting his many petty strongholds, seldom remaining more than a month in any one of them. The immediate objects of Orkan's ambition, on his accession, were the Greek cities of Nicaea and Nicomedia, with their surrounding districts, the last important possessions of the Byzantine Empire in Asia. Nicaea was then a great city. It had attained greater importance during the 60 years when the Latins were in occupation of Constantinople, and the Greek emperors were relegated to Asia and made it their capital. It was well fortified. It could only be captured, as Brusa had been, by cutting off its communications with Constantinople and depriving its people of the means of subsistence. The Greek emperor, Andronicus III, made an effort to relieve it. He hastily raised an army of mercenaries in 1326 and led them across the Bosphorus. He fought a battle against Orchan at Pelikanon, on the north shore of the Gulf of Nicomedia. According to the Greek historians, the Ottomans had much the worst of it, losing a great number of men, while the losses of the Greeks were trivial. However that may have been, Andronicus decided on a retreat. But a scrimmage occurred in the night between his bodyguard and the enemy, in which the emperor himself was slightly wounded. He thereupon fled precipitately, and was conveyed in a litter to the Bosphorus and thence to Constantinople. His army, 22 dispirited by this abandonment by their emperor, was defeated and dispersed. As a result, Nicaea surrendered in the following year, 1327, on favorable terms. The majority of its garrison and citizens followed the example of those of Brusa and adopted Islam. Very few availed themselves of the offer to transfer themselves to Europe. This ill-starred campaign and cowardly flight of Andronicus was the last effort of the Byzantine emperors to save their possessions in Asia. What remained of them, chiefly the city of Nicomedia, were left to their own resources without further aid from Europe. Nicomedia was well fortified and was apparently a tough job for the Ottomans, for it held out till 1337, or possibly 1338, and eventually surrendered in the same way and on the same terms as Brusa and Nicaea. In the interval of 10 years between the capture of Nicaea and Nicomedia, Orchan was further engaged in extending his state elsewhere in Asia, not towards Angora, in the south, as stated by some historians, but to the northwest, in the ancient Mysia, by the conquest of the Emirate of Kurasi, which lay immediately to the north of Sarakan and with a frontage to the sea opposite to the island of Mytilene. The emir of this state died in 1333. His two sons disputed the succession. The younger one was favored by the Ottomans, and when he was put to death by his brother, Orchan sent an army ostensibly to avenge him. The emir was driven into exile, and his state was promptly annexed by Orchan. The same fate befell some other petty emirates on the southern borders of the Marmora and the Hellespont, rounding off the boundary of the Ottoman state in the northwest corner of Anatolia. The population of Kurasi and the smaller states was mainly Turkish, but there must have been many Greeks on the coast who probably adopted Islam, as had the majority of the Greeks of Brusa and Nicaea. After these acquisitions, and that of Nicomedia in 1338, there were no further additions to the Ottoman state in Asia Minor during Orkan's reign. There followed, after the capture of Nicomedia, a few years of peace, and it may well be that, during this time, Orchan completed the scheme for the organization of his state and his army. Hitherto, when Othman and Orchan were involved in disputes with their neighbors, and at 23 was necessary to use armed force in resistance or attack, an appeal was made for the voluntary service of all the male members of their petty state or clan capable of bearing arms, and the appeal was responded to without question. When the occasion for their service was at an end, the warriors returned to their homes and to their usual vocations. With a rapidly expanding territory, and with great ambitions for further conquests, it was evidently thought necessary to constitute a permanent and well-disciplined force. And Orchan, whether adopting or not, the plans of his brother Aladdin, determined to effect this. On the one hand, he enrolled a considerable body of infantry for continuous service. They were subject to strict discipline and were well paid, and it will be seen that they could be sent beyond the realm to assist the Greek emperor or otherwise. On the other hand, a large body of horsemen was provided, not under continuous service, but under obligatory service when occasion arose for calling them out. For this purpose, the country districts were divided into fiefs, the holders of which were bound to serve in the event of war, and to come provided with horses and equipment, or to find substitutes in proportion to the extent of their fiefs. It was, in fact, the adoption of the feudal system, then almost universal in Europe, with this marked difference, that the fiefs were small in extent and were not, as a rule, hereditary. They were given for life as rewards for military service, and on the death of their holders were granted to other soldiers, though in some cases hereditary claims were recognized. When new territories were acquired by conquest from non-Muslims, large parts of them were divided into new fiefs, and were granted to the soldiers who had distinguished themselves in the war. Military service, whether in the new infantry or in the feudal cavalry, was strictly confined to Muslims. Christians, who were thus exempted from military duty, were subjected to a heavy capitation tax from which Muslims were free. This new organization of the army, commenced by Orchan and extended and perfected by his son Murad, who also, it will be seen, created the famous corps of Janissaries, converted the nascent Ottoman state into a most powerful engine for war, and gave an immense 24 impetus to the conquest of non-Muslim countries. Most splendid rewards were held out to the Muslim soldiers for victory and bravery. In the event of victory, they benefited not only from the ordinary booty in money and chattels, on the sack of cities, and the pillage of country districts. They also received as their share 4/5 of the proceeds of the sale of captives as slaves, the other 1/5 being reserved as the share of the Sultan. The captives were not only the enemy's soldiers taken in battle, but in many cases the inhabitants of the conquered districts. The strong and the young of both sexes were carried off and were sold, the men as slaves, the fairer women for wives or concubines or for harems. The soldiers further received, as has been shown above, a large share of the confiscated lands to be held as military fiefs in reward for bravery in battle. As these fiefs were granted for life only, there was a further distribution among the soldiers of the fiefs held by their comrades who were killed in battle, and often, it is said, the same fiefs changed hands many times in the course of a campaign. The Muslim inhabitants of a conquered territory were not sold off as slaves, nor were their lands confiscated. These measures were reserved for Christians or non-Muslims. In some cases, the Christians were given the option of embracing Islam in order to avoid slavery and the confiscation of their land. But these exceptions were rare in the conquests in Europe, and it is obvious that, to whatever extent they took place, the rewards obtained by the soldiers were reduced. It has been shown that hitherto, in the Ottoman conquests in Asia Minor, at the expense of the Byzantine Empire, a great proportion of the Christian population embraced Islam, and it may well have been that the spread of Islam and the conversion of infidels to the true faith were in part the incentives for the expansion of the Ottoman Empire. But henceforth, after the organization of the army by Orchan and Murad, and the great rewards held out to the soldiers for the conquest of non-Muslim territories, it does not appear that the Ottoman armies were inspired by any missionary zeal for the spread of Islam. The main, if not the sole motives, were loot and plunder, the sale of captives as slaves, and the confiscation of land and its distribution among the soldiers as fiefs, and these objects 25 were attained to a far greater extent by the invasion of Christian states in Europe than by the extension of the empire over Muslim countries in Asia. In the year 1354, Orchan, after completing the organization of his army, turned his attention for the first time to Europe. Thenceforth, till his death in 1359, his restless ambition was directed against the Byzantine Empire. Advancing age prevented his taking the field himself at the head of his army. But his eldest son, Soliman, who had all the great qualities of his race.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.